Hi, Mark here from the Tangentbound Podcast Network and host of the flagship show, the Tangentbound Podcast. Did you know that we over at Tangentbound are always looking for amazing podcasts to promote? And did you also know that we are also proud nerds and geeks of everything from movies, music, gaming, TV shows, and comic books to wrestling, MMA, soccer, and football? Whatever you can nerd or geek out about, we've got it. And if you're interested, we can help you find it. And if you're a show looking for a place to call home, we've got you covered. Side effects may include upset stomach, dizziness, tumors, shakes, and in some rare cases, death from excessive laughter. Though to be fair, it's only sometimes. Other side effects may include diarrhea, gallstones, heart palpitations, and strong desire for cookies on the dark side. Talk to your doctor and visit TangentBoundNetwork.com and see if Tangentbound Network is right for you.
Brian and Hanno, and I'm Jen. Hey guys, how are you
doing?
Hi.
I swear we're here. I'm so sorry to leave you all. But no, it's just been, it has been a crazy life lately. Yep. For I think all three of us. Yep. So we apologize for not being consistent. But
no, we don't.
Nope, we're owning it.
We own it. Yep.
I'm owning it.
We need to, because quite frankly, there's only so many times you can apologize for the same thing over and over again.
Yep.
With it losing its
well, yeah,
meaning,
especially when you just repeat the behavior.
and especially,
we just keep
since
repeating it.
We're going to talk about it tonight.
Oh,
we
are? All right.
It's all going to become very clear why.
This is true. Hanno's pregnant.
Yeah, is this a but we'll get to that episode?
but we'll get to that.
Yes, his morning sickness has kept him away from his night podcasting.
Mm-hmm,
it's really horrible how that works.
Yeah, that and the heartburn.
It's menopause.
Yeah.
It's menopause. Yeah, I can believe that. Yeah, well, we won't go there for me. But anyways, we'll skip past the whole thing. Let's just say the world's getting a lot warmer than it ever has been.
Yeah, tell me about it. Whew. I've been going through it since I was a baby. I've had hot flashes forever.
Let's just say, Brian, you remember how cold I've always been?
Yeah.
I'm sitting in my apartment with the door to my balcony open in a tank top.
Same. Wait. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yep.
Well, Sharon walked in last week and she's like, why is it so hot in here? I'm like, yes, I can finally turn the thermostat down. The change is occurring.
Yep. Times, they are a-changing.
I had to accept living in a very warm house. And you do get used to it, you know.
Yeah.
But I was finally like, yes.
Yeah. Well, it is funny, though, because where me and Jen are right now, typically it's in the 60s. But for the last, I don't know, week and a half, it's been like 70 or higher.
It's really weird. And at one point, just to tell you how bad it got, at one point my apartment was 61. And I considered turning the heat on. But I just closed the window.
Yeah, because we are in that time of year here where like through the day it's like 75, and then as soon as the sun goes down, it's like 45. You know, in like no, not right away, but you know, by like 10, 11 o'clock at night, it'll be down into the 40s or you know, low 50s. So, you know, if you don't mind, I'll go ahead and go first here. And,
please,
like a couple weeks ago, Tony and I went to visit listener of this show and one of our pals, Cheeto Bandito.
And do not gloss over the magnitude of this visit.
Oh, I won't. I've got a whole big roundabout thing here. So,
just making sure.
Yeah, this whole episode's me, by the way. So no. well, it has been a while. So we go down to visit him, and as I said on Salty Language, you know, went down home, land of my people. As both sides of my family, actually, I have relatives that are from, you know, the great state of West Virginia. And, you know, it was kind of fun because, you know, those that did speak with any sort of real accent and whatever, I didn't have any trouble understanding because, again, my people. So, but, wow, I totally already forgot where I was going with this. Wow, I just completely...
That's another symptom of menopause, by the way.
Yeah, it's also a symptom of a lot of things. Yeah. So,
I suggest some ginkgo biloba.
Nah, I'll forget about it. So anyway, but you know, so we went and did that, which was so good for me to do. One, I haven't been on any real trip in a while since pre-COVID. You know. And, you know, we used to do beer fest and stuff like that for a weekend or whatever and whatever. And it kind of got, you know, again, with COVID, that all kind of went by the wayside. So doing this was huge because, you know, again, I've been fighting agoraphobia and not wanting to leave the house and all this and whatever. And this is, you know, about a 4.5 hour car ride, even though, you know, we stopped a few times. But it was so much fun. And we talked about this on Salty Language, but just him and his friends could not have been more welcoming to us. It felt like we were just going to hang out with old friends. Like, it didn't even feel like, you know, really that awkwardness of meeting new people just really wasn't there for the most part. It was for me before we got there, of course, you know, because anxiety, you know, anxiety's gonna anxiety, so you know. So the night before, and even the day of, you know, the day we went, and you know, he had a birthday party there, and that day, I was so anxious. And Tony and I went and got lunch, and afterwards, I was sitting there, and I mean, I came real close to just going, "Dude, I'm gonna just hang back, and later, if I'm feeling less anxious, I'll catch an Uber." Over or something. And I was just like, you gotta go. Just kept, you know. And I went, and my stomach was upset and my nerves were on edge, you know, the whole time. But once we got there, again, everybody was so nice and inviting that it quickly dissolved. And you know, I still, like, my stomach still had some issues through the day and whatever, but it was not as bad as I thought it was going to be, of course, because it never is, you know, or I shouldn't say never, rarely is. But like I told Tony when we got back, honestly, it was on the way back, and I was like, this weekend was so good for my soul. Just sitting around having great conversations with people, no BS as far as like, you know, no life stuff really getting in the way, just sitting around having a good time. You know, having some beers and sitting around a fire and just really enjoying the company and everything. It was exactly something I didn't realize how badly I needed in my life, you know, and how much I had missed that. And it was such a great time. I'm so glad I went. But like you said, Jen, it's like I also and very much understand how big of a thing this was for me to go, not only just go, but go push through my issues both days, because we no more and got down there Friday. And I mean, we basically threw our stuff in the room and then headed off. Like normally, and as Heno can attest, like when we got to Chicago, I wish we, you know, like we didn't do that. And you saw how I reacted when we got to that bar, to where I was just deer in headlights because I was way too overstimulated. And really looking back for self-care reasons, I probably should have been like, hey, let's kick it here for about half an hour or so. Let me just kind of have some quiet in the room type of thing, and then let's get after it. But because I did feel that way, like when we got back to the room Friday night and Saturday night both, I was very much empty. You know, like I knew going into like after Friday night, I'm like, it's going to be probably Wednesday before I feel right again. Like, this is good. This is the best exhaustion. But so I'm putting myself in my way. I'm putting myself out there for too long without a reprieve, you know, because I mean, we got, you know, it was like 2 o'clock or Friday. We got there at like, I don't know, it was 5 or 6:30, something like that. And we stayed at his house until 2:30 in the morning. And then Saturday we were there till 1:30, and we got there at like, I don't know, 3 o'clock or something like that, you know? So that's a lot of on time for me. But again, all good, but I was right. Got home Sunday, was just exhausted, I went to bed early on Sunday, slept great because it was, you know, I was at rest. I was really at ease. Also, I was exhausted, but, and same with Tuesday. I slept a really good Tuesday, which was wild for me because I don't know the last time I got 2 good nights of sleep in a row, you know? But each day I could feel like I still wasn't at 100%, you know, going back to like the spoons episode we talked about, I was starting at probably 5 or 6 on those days, not in a bad way, but it was just my battery hadn't fully recharged yet. You know, but I like I said, had a great time. At some point we're probably going to do it again. You know, so that was big. You know, and I have yet to talk to my therapist and stuff about it, but I'm sure they're going to both be like, yeah, that was huge, you know, because not only did I just leave my house, but we went way away and, you know, whatever. And also, that was the first time Tony and I had done anything like this in who knows how long, where it was just the two of us just, you know, being idiots and whatever. So that was awesome, too, is we both were like, we need to do this more often. Like, this is something we should have been doing more all the time. And we just didn't. So, you know, yeah. So that's that part of things. I still can't remember where I was going with originally and why I was like, oh, go ahead and go first.
well, I'm going to interrupt you before you move past this.
Uh-oh.
Because there's a couple things that need to be said.
Oh, okay.
First, Cheeto, he's lying. But everything he just said and how often you are, I'm telling you, man. He hated every moment of it. No, of course,
well,
I am
kidding. We got down there and met his neighbor, and we got along with his neighbor like gangbusters. And, you know, Cheetah was like, oh, man, I was afraid I was going to lose my friends to him. I'm like, your friends? We came down here to see him.
Exactly. No, I want to make sure that we point out on the show, as well as just underscore everything that you've just said, which is we've got some heroes tonight. You obviously are the number one hero here because you've faced a lot of demons in that one weekend.
Yeah, I did, really. The last time I did this was when we went to Chicago. That weekend I, you know, faced anxiety and all the doubt in my head and all this other stuff. Well, and also, you know, like Tony and I going down, like he had met Cheeto before. I hadn't. So in my head, I'm like, you know, it's like, he listens to the podcast all the time, you know, so without even thinking about it, you're just like, is there an expectation I have to meet?
Mm-hmm.
No, there really wasn't. Or his expectation actually was for me to just be myself.
Exactly.
Right? But you don't think that way. You know, you think, oh, man, he probably thinks I'm, you know, funny all the time or this and that, and I'm not. And, you know, and then you get down there and it was like, oh, actually, everything is, you know, as it should be here. So yeah, that was cool.
So I mean, that's the first one for sure. And yeah, also keep in mind, Chicago was spur of the moment, wasn't it?
No, Chicago was planned.
No, it was planned.
Yeah,
that was planned. Okay.
Yeah.
Well, never mind.
Well, and so, that's the other thing. Like the longer I have, the worse it is. Spur of the moment can be really bad for me, but it also sometimes can help me to where I don't have enough time for the anxiety. Other times,
that's what I was thinking. Yeah. I was like, wait a minute, this one's planned, and there was one before Chicago then that was kind of spur of the moment.
Yeah.
That was Comic-Con, I think, wasn't it?
No.
Yeah. It was a There was one where it was like Nick and a few of the guys.
Oh, Gen Con. Gen Con's what you're thinking of. Yeah, because that was the one where they were like, hey, we have a, you know, do you want to go? And it was like the day they were leaving, basically. Yeah.
Correct. Yeah.
Yeah.
So,
by the way, just for reference, we went to Chicago how many years ago, Hanno? Do you have a guess on that? 5, 6 years ago, 7 years ago?
Yeah,
it's been a while, but not a ton.
Yeah.
Now, the trip you're referencing, Jen, was while my dad was still alive. So that was 17. Yeah,
it was.
Yes, it was.
No, we were not together at that time.
Oh, then it was something.
When you went to Gen Con.
Yeah, we were, because I didn't want to go because my dad. I was afraid he would die while I was gone. I was terrified of that. And they talked me into going. My dad talked me into going. I wouldn't have went, but he talked me into going.
Fair enough.
Anyway.
All right. Well, we'll let that one go.
Yeah, anyway, moving on.
Moving forward. So first off, obviously, hero of the night would be Brian. But the not-to-be-undersold secondary hero, which he will hate every moment of being called that, would be Mr. Tony. Mm. Because there is no other person that could have done this.
It would have been
tough.
And
I think that...
Yeah.
I think that we could all pretty much agree that there is no other person on this planet that could have been your wingman for this trip.
Yeah, probably. It's a very short list, for sure.
He
almost died in his sleep on the second night, though, because of his snoring. But
well, that's fair.
Because as I've said, I am forever cursed to whoever I share a room with is the loudest snorer in the group going. So
of course.
The fact that you did not take a picture of you holding the pillow,
missed
over
opportunity.
His face,
yeah, and just be like,
it's a crime.
Yeah, just be like, just remember, you were this close.
You were this close. This close.
That would be amazing.
Yeah.
So, yes, and Tony, I've said it before, you know, it amazes me the strength and the depth of your guys' friendship. It just is awe-inspiring. So, kudos to you for being the friend.
Yeah.
And Cheeto, kudos to you, man. I said, you're not being undersold in this,
yeah,
in this, the scenario here either. Mm-hmm. The fact that you have such a strong heart and such a strong, just love of life and love of people that you're willing to open your doors to people that you barely know and you only listen to on the podcast, introduce them to your family, to your friends, and just welcome them in with just open arms.
And now we know where he lives, so that was a terrible idea.
Exactly.
Yeah.
I mean, seriously, you're going to tell these people where you live? I mean, dude.
Was it last week, I think it was on Saturday, his neighbor was having a Halloween party, and he was like, hey, Derek's having a Halloween party tonight. Y'all should head on down. And I said to Tony, I'm like, we should go. It's only 4.5 hours, you know. Yeah, and I know we'd be welcome. They were great, so yeah.
Yeah, and that's amazing. And and there's not nearly enough people like that in this world.
Yeah.
So kudos to Cheeto.
That's enough about those idiots. So
yeah,
let's go back to praising me. What?
Except he sold the guitars.
That's true. He did sell his guitars.
He sold the guitars.
Yeah. I completely blanked about that too. While we were down there, he made a comment about how he'd love to talk with Hanno or hang out with him, and or FaceTime. He goes, or even FaceTime
me.
And I looked at Tony, and I looked at Cheeto at the time, and I was like, we can text him real quick, find out. I'm like, well, just see if he's home and if he's up. I'm like, he's probably awake because it wasn't that late. And he was like, really? And then Tony just fires off a text to Hanno, and next thing you know, Hanno's on FaceTime with him.
Oh, hell no!
Yeah.
All right, Cheeto, I take back everything I just said about you.
I never thought we could have tried to put Jen in there, too.
Don't even try now. Don't even try.
I had had a lot of beer at that point.
Don't even try. At one point when you had a lot of beer, I was the first thought in your mind.
Yeah.
Not the last one, mister.
Yeah, that was a long time ago, though. I mean, I've had a lot of beer since then. No, that's true.
I see how it is. I get it.
It was fairly late for the East Coast, but it was not late at Hanno's time because I knew he was hours behind us. So, you know, a little different.
You can try to justify all night.
I'm going to guess you were probably not available. Yeah. But so while I was there, I got to meet the biggest dogs I've ever met in my life. They had a bloodhound, which was a decent sized dog, probably 80 or so pounds. Very stick its nose into all of your orifices because it's a bloodhound. That's what they do. That's how they get to know you.
Absolutely.
Super sweetheart of a dog. Then the next dog comes out and it's a Saint Bernard, which is a large dog and could not have been more of a sweetheart. Immediately upon seeing me, came over, sat on my foot and just lifted its head, put its head up and back so that I could give it scritches on the neck and stuff.
Aww.
Yeah. Like I said, super sweetheart of a dog. And then this behemoth of an animal comes out. That's their third dog. I don't remember what breed it is, but oh my God, this dog, I think he said it goes like 150 pounds, made the Saint Bernard look small. And I'm just like, what is this thing that I could probably ride around your backyard?
Yeah.
And it's their neighbor's dogs.
My buddy Dave's Great Pyrenees is like that too. It's like, man, people actually stop him on the street to take pictures of themselves with the dog because it's so massive.
We tried to get pictures with the dog's name's Loki. We tried to get pictures with him, but every time someone pulls a camera out, the dog moves. Like, he won't stay still then, right? But I was just like, we're walking around their house because they had it all decorated for Halloween. We're walking around. These three dogs are just basically herding us where they want to go because there's too much beef to fight there. There's like 400 pounds of dog, you know? So, and I'm like, I can't imagine walking around like this because these dogs are like, you're going where they want to go, you know? Like, was... So, like I said, they were giving Loki some medicine and I was like, is he good with it? And Derek's like, yeah. You know, I was like, well, that's good because I can't imagine trying to get that dog to do anything it doesn't want to do. But again, could not have been a sweeter dog. He was so, so sweet. But this, again, goes to my issues because I typically don't do well around big dogs, even if they're the biggest, friendliest beasts on the planet, right? Like, pit bulls are not huge dogs, but they're big and strong, and usually that's what I don't like to be around. But I've gotten now between the you know, Belle that Tony and Jeannie had and now Bomber that Tony has, I've been around them enough to where it doesn't bother me as much. And I finally really saw that this weekend. Like, when we got around those dogs, I immediately was just like, who's a good boy? Rather than, you know, like, big dogs, you know, except for the one. Cause at first, when I saw him, I was like, that is a huge dog. He was like, when we were down the hill from him the night before and we heard him like howling a little bit at us, we're like, what the hell is that? And I'm like, you know, is that a werewolf or something? And they were like, yeah, close.
You're again, such a dog-sizist.
Yeah, I am, aww. But it's more of a, I'm just, I usually have a fear with dogs. And I didn't really, it was, you know, and then Cheeto, I can't leave Cheeto's dog, Charlie, out, who's a golden retriever. And again, a sweet, good boy. And, you know, was very much the, we were all sitting in his garage and the dog comes out and, you know, it's the, you know, puts his head on your leg, and you pet him for a while, and you stop, and then he's, like, sticking his head under your hand to try to get you to keep petting him, or puts his paw on your leg, like, ahem, you know? So, yeah, it was good boys all around, but actually, I remember, I think one of the dogs might have been female, but I don't remember now. I think the St. Bernard might have been. I don't know. I can't remember. So anyway, so yeah, that wraps that up and, you know, came back and, you know, got back to, just normal stuff here, but I've been meeting every week except this week with the, I think he's a psychologist that I'm meeting with that's assessing me for the ADHD. Cause again, he told me it'd be about 4 to 6 sessions. I think next week is session 5. So I'm getting close to the end, I think. And most of it has just been him asking me questions. This last week, he actually gave me a couple tests to do. And the first one is like, you know, you have a sheet with like a rectangle in it. And it's like 1, 2, 3, 4, blah, 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 right? And you draw a line from 1 to 2. And they're not, you know, they're like 1 is on one side of the paper, 2 is on the other. You know, they're all over the paper. And the point is to kind of test your focus. So, you know, as soon as he says go, he's like, try to do it as quick as you can, go. And I'm like, done. He's like, okay, the second one was a bigger sheet, same idea, done. Third one, you go 1A, 2B, 3C, 4D, like that, right? And it's a smaller thing, and a boom, burn through it. Bigger one, burn through that. And I was like, yeah, I never had issues with that stuff because my brain fires pretty quick. like, you know, he had me do the alphabet forwards and backwards and no problems with that. He had me do like, okay, 1, 3, 7, right? He's like, just keep adding 3. And of course I just ripped through that because that's the kind of math I've always been really good at anyway. My dad always taught me to do math in my head. So those kind of things. Then he's like, okay, now I'm going to read a paragraph and I want you to repeat the paragraph to me afterwards. He reads this paragraph and I can give him about 4 words from it. That's it. That's all I could recall. Like, because he tells you details, like a person's name, where they're from, this happened, you know, and I honestly probably just gave you a better recap than I gave him. And he goes, okay, you know, think for a minute and then try again. Couldn't pull anything better. So he's like, okay, we're going to move on to another one. Does it again. I shit the bed. Sorry. Messed the bed really badly on this one too. And I'm sitting there going, wow, right? Because I haven't done this test in a long time. The last time I did it, I aced it.
Wow.
Because I remember it was, you remember that appointment I had to go to, Jen, where we had to sit for, or no, it wasn't that one. It was another one I went to though, but I had to sit for like 2 hours before I finally got back. And when the woman gave me that, it was a different setup though. And because usually what they used to do in the ones I've had before was they would give you a list. You know, they'd say like apples, oranges, bananas, pears, and then they would talk to you. Then after they were done talking to you, you had to repeat the list. Well, that one's easy because all I do is sit there and go apples, oranges, bananas, pears, apples, oranges, bananas, pears the whole time. I don't even listen to what they're saying because I know the test is saying repeat the list. The test doesn't say repeat the paragraph and the list. It just says repeat the list. So that tells me that whole paragraph is inconsequential. It's similar to like if you read a story problem, right? A lot of people that struggle with story problems because they get caught up in so much information. And I always tell people the easiest way to do them, read the questions first, then go find your answers. Don't read the paragraph first. Read the questions and then go find your answers. Way easier. So, and that's something my brain does is when I'm being tested, my brain goes, what is information is necessary and what isn't? And what isn't, I throw out immediately, right? Which is good and bad because that's how I got through a lot of stuff in school was what is the teacher looking for? Here's exactly what you're looking for. Cool, I got an A. Did I learn anything? I don't know. But what I learned was how you want me to fill out a paper. Now, granted, that's how a lot of people do it without really, but I consciously do that, you know. So anyway, we get done and he goes, wow. He goes, you aced the papers and just, you know, completely were terrible on the other, basically. And he's like, but that makes sense. He's like, because you told me you're an artist. And I was like, okay. And he goes, you communicate via paper, creating. This is how you converse. He's like, you aren't a, you know, he's like, you're not like, you know, long conversations and whatever. That's not how you talk with people, essentially. That's not how you express yourself. You express yourself more via your work. And he told me, he said, it's really common for artists to test that way, to where they're really good at on paper stuff, but really bad at stuff in your head. And I was like, but some of the stuff in your head, I was really good at. And he's like, sure, you can have, you know, that. But he said, overall, he said, you know, your scores on the paragraphs were really bad, which I didn't doubt. It was a little stark to, you know, experience it. Because, like I've been saying for years now, I can't read the way I like to because when I'm done, I have zero recall. And, I mean, I used to test, like in junior high and high school, they would give us tests every year for your reading comprehension and recall. And on those recall tests, I would get like 98, 99%. I mean, I would kill those things. And now, I mean, like I told you, out of a paragraph, I'm like, I can remember like this name and this, then that's it. You know, it's like if you read a book and you can remember one page of the book kind of a thing. So, but he told me that where I struggle is with complex verbal memory, apparently, which, you know, knowing me, first thing I do after I hang up with him, right to the internet to see what that is how I can understand it better. But the problem is that the stuff you find online about it is mostly for people who are in the academic field. It's very, very, here's a paper that belongs in a research magazine or journal or something. And I'm like, oh boy, like I don't want to read, like, I can't read that stuff. As much as I bet if you handed that to me in junior high, I probably would have devoured it, read it, comprehended it, all that stuff. Now, you know, now a paragraph in and I'm like, oh my, I'm so tired. Like, like I don't have the attention span for it. But one of the things this guy said to me that I absolutely loved was when he was talking about this, he was like, I just want you to know this has nothing to do with intelligence. He's like, this is all memory and you know, things you're dealing with. And I was like, once again in my life, I had a doctor tell me those words, essentially, or a you're not alone kind of situation. And it was like a phrase I had never heard before, right? Like, it was just like, oh, because it was weird. I had just talked to my therapist about how a lot of my fears with some things is one of my greatest fears is losing my mental faculties. It is maybe my biggest fear. I'm terrified that I'm going to end up with, you know, dementia or Alzheimer's or something along those lines. And when he said that to me, it was almost like he knew that that was my biggest fear and was just like, hey, just to let you know, the thing you fear the most here is not the reason for this. Like, you're not losing your mental faculties necessarily. He's like, your recall across the board is not bad, you know? And he's like, and if it is, he's like, you know, you're 44. He's like, you're not old, but he's like, you know, the brain changes as we age and whatever. So, but he then said, like, when we were all kind of done, he's just kind of talking a little more casual. And he was like, you need to get back to art. And I was like, okay. And he was like, because right now, he's like, you express yourself through art. He's like, if you're not creating, you're not expressing yourself. So it's no wonder that you're depressed. And I was like, fuzza, what? And I mean, boom, right? And I was like, I had not ever thought of that. And I think about it so much since. It was like, think about Henno when you weren't playing with your band, remember? And when you got back to playing and you were like, man, I needed that. I needed the process, the outlet. And I think of other artists that I know, Michelle, and different ones that have used it in their healing from depression or whatever, or that it's changed their life again. And I was like, he's right. And then he was like, we're going to see if we can figure out a way to get you back to that. And I was like, this guy's good. Like, I mean, and he's not that far away, I believe. I may talk to him about, like, if it's possible to continue seeing him, because I feel like because of the nature of his job, he's really good at seeing through things, right? Like, he's talked with so many people, he knows what he's looking for. And when he finds that crack, he can weasel into that and go, this is a problem. And I think that might be exactly what I need. Because what I need really, really and truly, to put it as simply as possible, I really need someone to just pat my head and say it's going to be okay.
Me too.
But I need it on a deeper intellectual level than that. I need them to explain why it's going to be okay, essentially. Mm-hmm. But I get that vibe from him. But I really like this guy. And I'm going to make sure I mention that to them, that it's like, hey, I don't know who else you got, but this guy, for me, was, you know, a million bucks. Like, this is probably the guy I needed to see, because that statement really made me think about a lot of stuff. And over the last few weeks, I've been reading off and on stuff that people have posted on ADHD and different stuff of how ADHD can be the cause of anxiety, in that you have a, like, Jen can attest to this. I cannot lose my house keys. If my house keys are not where they're supposed to be, I go crazy. And I don't mean you know, to use that term incorrectly, but I lose my mind a little bit. So I put my keys in the same spot because I have a fear of losing my keys. And if I don't put them in that spot, then all I can think about is I got to put my keys in the right spot. Like if I put my keys on my desk instead of over here where I normally keep them to my left, it will bother me. I'll have to get up out of bed and come fix that problem. So that's where, like, I've told him stuff like that, because that's where, like, the obsession part of things comes in. And that's why it's wild, because of the stuff I'm being tested for. And I'm like, at the end of this, it's hard not to look at some of this and go, why do I have to have so much wrong with me? like I feel like, you know, we talked about our friend Jeannie, how she has a lot of letters after her name because of all of her certifications and her training. Mm-hmm. I feel like I have about the same length of stuff after my name if you just abbreviate my conditions. So, and I know it doesn't mean that there's anything wrong with me, but it's, you know, right. Those thoughts are going to be in your head. It's hard to get past that sometimes. And go, no. And even if it is, hey, you're working on it. You're trying. You're doing your best, you know. And it's that positive affirmation at the end of that is really difficult, as we all know. And it's nice because my therapist also like to point, like, make sure they reiterate, like, you're doing really good. Like, you're really fighting. You've come a long way. Those kind of things, you know. But like I said, it was such a warm hug almost from this guy the other day when he was like, this is not any sign of intellect. This is, you know, something is making your brain just not remember the way it should. And we will, you know, hopefully we can figure out a way to help you with that. And it was like I said, that was exactly that pat on the head I needed. You know, it was exactly like, oh, okay, maybe this isn't as bad as I thought. Because as I, you know, I've been forgetful, air quotes, since I was in my 20s. It's gotten worse and worse. And every time I tell somebody, oh, yeah, that's just age. And he was kind of like, no, it's not. You know, it can be, but it's not. I just chalked it up to that I've hit my head a lot of times in my ears. I just thought, well, maybe, you know, as we've seen with football players and stuff, it does add up. You know, it does make, you know, can make a difference. But I'm like, I've never really had concussions and stuff. These are just like, you know, racking your head on a car or something like that. Not, oh, wow, where did the last 5 minutes of my life go? You know, so anyway, I think that's most of where I'm at and what I was going to talk about. I have other stuff. Oh, I have one last thing, and this is going to be a topic of an upcoming show, which was another kind of moment that kind of made me laugh a little bit, because when you hear it, you're kind of like, all right, was the last time I was in therapy, we were talking about my perfectionism and where it comes from and all that kind of stuff. And my therapist was like, have you ever tried just lowering your expectations? And I laughed because, you know, when you say that to somebody, you think of just settling in life or taking less than you deserve and all this. And it's not. That isn't at all what she meant. She meant simply like, dude, you're shooting for way above the stars. Like, maybe bring it down to the stars or the moon. You know, like let's keep it a little more realistic. And you know, instead of shooting for perfection, shoot for just, you know, done or good or whatever. You don't have to be like, when you do a piece of art, it doesn't have to be like immediately a museum doesn't have to call you and want to hang it on the wall. You know, like, it can just be something you do for yourself. You can crumple it up and throw it right in the trash afterwards. Heno, how many times have you written a song and it's gone nowhere, really? Or you stop partway through and you're like, meh. You know, like, I can't do that anymore. I used to be able to. You know, I told you about that, how I'd be working on different drawings at the same time. I can't imagine that now. If I was working on a drawing, I think I would be all in on that drawing or not at all on it. Because that's, I think, am I right, Jen? I mean, you've seen me doing work. That's pretty much, I think, where I'm at, is that my brain feels like I have to laser focus or no focus. That's all I get. I don't get any sort of focus. So, anyways, there we go. I think that's long enough for me. So, whoever wants to go next, good luck following that. No. I just brought you like 3 aha moments. Good luck.
Dude, that's impressive.
I did. I 100% own that I've really... I've been a mess over the last few weeks. I've had some real depression. I've had some aha moments. I've had some real hopefulness. I mean, I really feel like emotionally I've been all over, but then I stopped and was like, that's fantastic. Because
yes, it is.
For a long time, I only had one emotion, which was meh. So to be all over the board is not all bad. That's typical. That's what we all go through. So
that's
I was
neurotypical.
Yep. So cheers to that, I guess.
Absolutely.
All right. Who's next?
Well, I'll go real quick.
Boring. Boring.
Yeah, pretty much.
I'm kidding. I'm just being a jerk.
No, I mean, life's been good. I guess the thread that's kind of transpired through the entire last few weeks or so has been, it's okay to be me, which is really an odd concept I'm getting quite used to, because I think I'm finally at that point where I can no longer be what you want me to be. Mm. And I really can only be me. And being me means volatility, means emotional up and downs. Even on the best medicines that they make,
I can't
change that. I'm still going to be me.
Like I just was saying, right? Like even with medicines and stuff, it's like sometimes those are appropriate reactions. You know, they're not inappropriate. Yeah. And just because you're on a medicine doesn't mean you aren't allowed to have highs and lows and middles and, you know.
And you know what? It's all appropriate for me.
Yeah.
You know, bipolar is me. It is part of me.
There you go.
And whether it's the bipolar causing the emotional upheavals, if it's life, all of the above, it's going to happen. I'm going to be an irrational some days, and I'm going to overreact and I'm going to underreact. And quite frankly, that's going to be okay. Not because of anything other than the fact that that's me, you know?
Yeah.
I talk too much about myself. Probably. I'm conceited. Probably. But you know what? Doesn't change the fact that it's me. You know, things I want to work on, for sure. I'm not just going to blatantly accept, and I'm never wanting to be better or never wanting to grow myself. Of course not. You know, I always strive for better and I strive to grow myself. But just because I'm not meeting my expectations at every given moment doesn't mean I'm failing. It means I'm being human.
I think that kind of goes back to like my perfectionism thing, right? It's the same idea in that just because I didn't hit the mark I wanted to hit doesn't mean I haven't done really well. You know, I just have to be able to accept that, oh, actually, I did really well. Same with you. It's like, oh, actually, that's neurotypical, normal, whatever you want to call it. And I'm doing okay. You know?
Yeah. And I'm finally... For the first time in my life, I have never, like, really broken up with someone. Still haven't, honestly. But I finally, last week, came to this understanding in my mind, an understanding in my world, in this aha moment, that I really wanted someone to do and want things that they just didn't. And in the past, I would try to manipulate the situation and I would try to remind them or bring things to their attention to help spark the fact that they would want what I want them to want. Mm. And I finally came to the conclusion, I'm like, no, and that's okay. If they don't want what I want them to want, that's okay. If they can't be the person I want them to be, that's okay. Not to say that they're not trying, not to say that they're not exceeding in being the person that they want to be and who they are.
Right, in their mind, or as to their goals, they might be great.
Exactly, yeah, you know? Exactly.
But for what you need or want from a situation, they're falling short. It's amazing how we can... you can really be hitting it out of the park, but then someone else could be like, eh, you know.
I'm saying, and I came to terms with this. It's like, no, and just because they're doing the best that they can to be the person they want to be doesn't mean that's going to be enough for me, or I have to accept that as being enough for me.
True.
I can still love someone and love who they are, but recognize the fact that I am not the person for them, or they're not the person for me.
Yeah.
And it's really hard. And it about destroyed me, and it's still probably going to. But
that's okay too.
That's you know? Okay too.
By the way, Henno, you better have something good coming, because otherwise this episode's going to be called "That's and That's Okay."
So it was just it's one of those things that I'm really coming to terms with my value, what I need. Doesn't matter if it's reasonable, rational, or anything else. If it's what I need, it's what I need. And if someone can't provide that, they can't provide that. Mm-hmm. You know, and I have to accept that.
I love the change there. You were going to say that's okay, weren't you?
Shush. Hush you.
It's one of the things, no. I don't know why, but I have this thing where I do that with myself and with others. Is like if you say something or there's some little tick that a person has, mm-hmm. I seem to pick it up like immediately. Like every mm-hmm. podcast I listen to, I can probably tell you the crutch of the person that I listen to. I don't have to listen to many episodes, and I'll just be like, they do this all the time, and it's stupid brain that I want to turn off.
Yeah, someone pointed out to me, nice is my word.
Yeah.
And how I have a million and one ways of saying nice, and each one has a different meaning.
Right.
Yeah. So, and I'm like, really? They're like, oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Nice is 100% yeah. your word. I'm like, huh. It's good to know.
That's beautiful.
So now, of course, I try to avoid saying nice.
I would go the other way. I would go over the top with it. Much like, what's his name in Princess Bride? When he keeps saying inconceivable, you know,
yes.
he's using it wrong, you know.
Yeah. So anyways, it's just, yeah. So, yeah. And work is getting rougher. But again, I'm getting to this point, and I don't know what is brought me here. Whether it's exhaustion, part of it. But or just tired of holding all the different masks up and trying to be what people expect me to be or want me to be and trying to change and adjust to every situation that I'm in. I'm just at that point now that, I mean, for lack of a better word, I'm like, F it. You know, I don't want to do that anymore.
It's exhausting. It really
yeah, it's
is
like,
exhausting.
If you find me conceited because I'm very knowledgeable and I want to impart my knowledge onto you, I apologize. Mm-hmm. I don't mean to come across as a know-it-all and conceited.
Oh, I just agree with the person.
Yeah.
Like, oh, you're such a know-it-all. Like, thanks.
Yeah.
I'm kidding. I know I am a know-it-all, but I don't want to be one. But again, that's how brain works. So,
yeah. And that's what, you know, and I feel bad, but there's reasons behind it. And I tried, you know, it's because I've made these mistakes and I don't want them making the mistakes.
Yep.
But it's their mistakes to make. So, you know, there's limits to what I should be, you know, I to push that limit, you know, but yeah, that's part of who I am. And I just can't, if I can't be in fear of what I'm going to lose so I don't do what I need to do and be who I need to be.
Yes.
I can't fear that anymore.
Right.
I have to be free to be who I am and make the best decisions I can make and trust in myself, in my resilience, and my ability to move past any obstacles that may stand in my way. It is no longer okay for me to hide and basically go under the covers and pretend things don't exist because they're uncomfortable or I don't want to face them.
Disagree. I do it all the time.
It is no longer okay for me to have for me to feel like I need to change me to fit in a situation.
Yeah.
If I have to change how I act, how I say, and what I do based upon the people I'm with, to a certain extent, of course, folks, we all know that we do in polite society have to change based upon search, you know, circumstances, situations, but outside of that normal adjustment, that is not a place for me to be.
Yeah. It's interesting. I just talked to my therapist about that as well, about being a chameleon and how for years and years I saw that as a strength. And looking at it now, I actually see that what it is it's a coping mechanism. Because what happens is, because of my anxiety or whatever, I go into a room and I don't want to say anything because I have a fear of offending, a fear of not being funny, not fitting in, fear of rejection. We'll just say that. And then, so I wait and read the room and then pick my spot so that I have an optimal chance for success. Because I can see what's fallen as funny and not funny and go, okay, well, these things I might normally say are not, or like you said, oh, they don't cuss much in here, so I better watch my language or blah, 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 you know, and you Rolodex to that person and go, okay. And it's like, oh yeah, that's great. I can fit in with any, it's like, no, buddy, that's actually a coping mechanism. And that's a sign of something that's negatively affected my life. So again, now with my, I'm being more honest in therapy. I made sure I pointed that out and my therapist was like, you've never mentioned that before.
Hmm.
Like, geez. So I feel you on that, you know.
Another layer of the onion.
That it works, but it's really not okay because I'm hiding something with it. So, yeah. And it's exhausting, like I said before.
Yeah, it is. It's super exhausting. But yet, I am, because of this, I swear I have not grown this much in my entire life, as much as I've done in the last 6 months.
Yeah, I'm kind of feeling that way too. Like that in the last few months, like since I had that, I'm not being honest with my therapist or myself.
Yeah.
Since that moment, my therapist even pointed that out to me when I was in there last time. She's like, you've told me stuff in the last two sessions that she's like, I've been seeing you for years that I didn't know about you.
Hmm.
I was like, huh. So, yeah.
Crazy how that happens.
Yeah, really? It's amazing how they can understand you better when you tell them things.
Amazing.
You can't just read my mind.
Well, this is culminating to a big, big week.
Uh-oh.
So next week, on Tuesday, I leave for Jacksonville Beach, Florida.
I'm so sorry.
No. there's a business conference that my work is sending me to.
Yeah.
It is Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday, and first business conference I've ever been to myself.
They're real jerks. They couldn't have made that Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, so maybe you could have a little vacation while you're there.
Oh, hang on, hang on. So, very first business conference I've ever been to, by myself, of course. Mm. That's a distance away, and it's... I'm the only person from our company going.
Oh, wow. Really?
I'm going to be, I'm going to be representing our company, representing my department, talking with people who are higher ups and are people that talk with my director and my manager on a regular basis.
Wow.
Finding a lot about new programs that I'm going to come back and have to present to my team and to my manager and my director and to determine if this is something that we want to invest in.
Mm-hmm.
And then after that, I decided to stay an extra couple days. So I reached out to some friends and nobody was available to go with me. And I thought about it. I'm like, you know what? I'm going to stay down there by myself.
Oh, wow.
And I am. And my dad put it best. He's looked at me. He's like, well, what are you going to do? I'm like, I have no idea.
Have a panic attack. Duh.
No. Thank you. He's like, what, nobody? You're not going to know anybody? I'm like, no, Dad, I'm not going to know anybody. I said, I'll probably go to the beach. I'll probably do a little window shopping. Probably go grab a drink and at some dinner at a bar, you know, and a nice restaurant, sit at the bar. Don't need to be taking up a table. And quite frankly, the bar's more entertaining anyways.
Yep, I agree.
So, yeah.
Even if you don't drink, yeah. It's way more fun to sit there. Conversations are
so
good.
So it's just, yeah. So that's what I'm going to do. Mm. And I'm not going to lie and say I cannot tell that people are nervous about me doing this. Because there are a lot of people nervous about both ends of this trip.
Well, there's a lot of it, too. And a lot of it's rooted in just the, you know, the old thinking of you're a female. You can't go somewhere by yourself. And I don't mean that in any real down way. But it's like the dangers that are out there, essentially. We've all heard and seen Dateline, you know. So, mm-hmm. you know, so that's and other stuff, you know. Yeah.
That's definitely part of it.
Yeah.
You know, being down there by myself outside of the conference, 100% there's definitely people that are nervous about that aspect. Yeah. There's people at work that are nervous about the aspect of me being the face of a company down at a conference, a customer conference. Not gonna lie, I know it's out there.
Yeah.
My manager already has a meeting set up with me on Monday for us to sit down and chit chat about.
It's just a list of things not to do. It's like, do not get sloppy drunk. Do not. Yeah.
Basically, with them, it's like more, do not make any commitments, especially financial ones. I don't care how good you think the deal is.
Yeah, right. I'll have to run this over or run this by whoever. Yeah.
Yes, yes. They're like, get names, numbers, and information and bring it back to us.
Yeah, you are on a data collection mission. You are not on a on a sales mission. Yeah. No, it's the truth, though. That is what you're there for. You're there to collect data and bring it back. Yep.
100%. That is what I'm down there for. Mm-hmm. So, and also, you know, there's a lot of expectation that, you know, this is my first time doing this on behalf of the company.
Yeah.
So, they have no idea how this is going to go for me.
Yeah.
They obviously trust me enough to set it up.
I'll be honest, nothing against you. I'm just surprised that they don't have another person going with you, if nothing else, to just kind of stand there and shut up and let, you know, just observe you to make sure, just in case if you do, kind of like if you have a lawyer with you at a deposition, you know, like... Like, they're there to make sure you don't cross a line you shouldn't cross, you know, like, whoa, 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 you know, like, so that's a lot of trust. I mean, that is a really powerful gift to give somebody, that much trust.
Yeah, it is. And I'm not gonna lie when I don't say I feel the weight, because I do.
Yeah, I would think so.
I am feeling the weight of this and trying to make sure everything is as professional as possible.
Right.
So this would be interesting to kind of see how it goes, and I'm happily report back to everyone after it's all said and done. And it's exciting. It's scary. It's there's a lot of pressure on me, but I feel strong enough for it right now.
It's one of those times where you hear people all the time now saying, a lot of times, instead of saying, I have to do this, is I get to do this. And that really, I think that reframing really goes a long way in like this scenario, right? Is instead of it saying, I have to have all this on me, or it's like, you get to have the opportunity to go do this. Like I said, I think it's amazing that a company, aside from just being cheap and not wanting to send two employees or something, but it's like, I think it's amazing that they're just like, yeah, she'll be fine. Not, we better send so-and-so who's been with the company 15 years or, you know what I mean? Or a boss or whatever, like to make sure everything goes smoothly. I think that's pretty awesome. And again, I think it goes to a lot of it, how much they value you. I really do. I think it has a lot to do with that. They see you clearly as a competent piece of the company, you know, or they're setting you up to fail, one or the other. I don't know. No.
Yeah, I'm sure at these things. And honestly, with corporate America, it goes both ways any day of the week.
Yeah,
so
true.
One day you're in, the next day you're out.
That's true.
That's kind of how it works.
I say it joking, of course. I really do feel that I think it's awesome that they're putting you in that spot. So I don't envy the pressure and then having to present when coming back, because that would make me go, oh, geez, I'm so sick, I can't go. But
yeah, it's going.
Can I record a podcast and then turn it over to you guys?
Yeah, and I am getting much more comfortable with the unknown right now.
Good. There's nothing wrong with that. Yeah.
Yeah, and I'm so much stronger in my self-confidence and my sense of self.
Yeah.
Than I ever have been in my whole life. Yeah. So it's all coming together now, and by no means am I not making mistakes, because I am making big old fat mistakes left and right.
Yeah, but everyone does.
Right. But the whole idea behind it is they don't destroy me like they used to. Mm-hmm. When I would make a mistake before, I would be like floored and in bed and sobbing. And Brian, you were there for a good portion of those.
Well, I think this company makes a big difference in that too, because the companies you've worked for in the past, I mean, if you sneezed the wrong way, it felt like they were giving you a performance review. You know,
yeah.
This one seems a little more like, hey, people screw up sometimes. It's okay. Learn from it and please don't repeat it. But, you know, and that's how it should, you know, when we're a little kid and we do something stupid, our parents punish us because it's wrong and we need to learn that it's wrong and there's consequences. Mm-hmm. But then you're allowed to go back out into the world and, you know, like it's something we should learn from time we're kids all the way up. And it never stops with that. You know, it's like you said, the biggest thing that stops most of us, and I can speak on this as well as anybody, is the fear of failure or the fear of whatever. It doesn't even have to be failure. I get stopped by things that don't even have to do with failure. Failure so far down the road, I haven't even gotten there. You know, like I have the fear of starting, let alone failure. And you're right. The more confidence you have and the more the company shows confidence in you, and that it's okay if you make a mistake, that allows you some freedom in that, to where you don't go. And I think in the past, you very much have worked under if I make a mistake, I'll probably be fired. Or I'm going to get significantly, you know, whatever. Like, you know, my job is going to suck for a while because I made a mistake. And nobody should have to keep, you know, it's like, okay, you punished me. Let's move past this. There's no reason to keep throwing it in my face for the rest of the year or next year, you know. So I'm glad that you finally got a company that seems, you know, to show you that they have confidence in you as well. That you're not.
Yeah, and they do, and it's really awesome. Mm-hmm. But don't get me wrong, I have had my issues for sure.
Oh, yeah.
Some of the same old shadows still follow me, unfortunately.
Corporate America, what are you gonna do? And yeah, you're gonna keep making some of the same mistakes because, you know, we're people.
Kind of, you know, we're people, and that's what happens.
Yep.
But the different way of me looking at it now is, even though financially I'd be screwed, but if I lost my job today, I'm confident in myself and my skills that I will find something else.
Yep, that's right.
And I've never felt that way.
Yeah.
I've always been so afraid of what's going to be around that next corner
that
I'm afraid to do anything.
That's exactly what I was talking about. That's the fear of starting. And it's funny because it's called the fear of failure, but it really isn't a lot of times, because it really almost is that fear of starting, because you're afraid of taking that step off that ledge, because what if the rope breaks, you know, like you're bungee jumping. What if the rope breaks? What if this, it's like, or you could just do it and you know,
yeah.
I'd be like, is this harness secure? I wouldn't even get to the edge. I'd be like, is this harness? Are you sure? Like, this wind is blowing a lot. Is this okay?
So, Hedo, I'll pass the torch on to you, darling.
Oh, so sorry, Hedo. We're out of time.
Yeah, exactly. No. Well, I stopped, whatever it was, a month ago now, I guess. We were going to podcast, and I sent a message saying that the leak we had in February has returned, and I am putting in some long nights. And that actually didn't happen very, very long. Omar and I both did, you know, if you recall, we would be going in all night long, just to add fluid to the system so we could heat this building in the middle of winter. And, we lost so much in one night. I came in the next day to work and I just said, we cannot heat this building.
Oh, wow.
And I just came out and said it. We're not, you know, we're not dumping tens of thousands of dollars of, you know, fluid into the freaking watershed this time to try to heat a building. You know, plus it was still actually unseasonally warm at the beginning of the month. And all my concern was is how are we going to get heat the we use boiler water to heat water in storage tanks. Those are our water heaters. And my only thing was, is how can I get hot water, make this happen? And we actually figured out a workaround for it, which was, it was pretty cool. And so by the next day, you know, they had heaters and they had hot water. And I just, you know, I told our GM, I said, go rent some heaters, go buy some radiator heaters. Yeah. I have no idea what's going to happen, how long it's going to take. And it was weird how like people weren't acting on it. And I was like, I'm not doing this part.
Right. Last time you didn't have a general manager, right? You handled it pretty much, or your team, I should say. I don't remember his, you know.
He showed up right in the process.
Oh, that's right.
Finished.
Okay. Because I was going to say it should be their job, shouldn't it? This time, that was one of the things I was holding on to, was like maybe Heno won't have to kind of spearhead it this time because he's got this other person now.
So it took a while for, you know, the GM to step up and start taking care of some things. Cause, you know, on one hand, we have my one coworker who's great about just picking up the phone and making the phone calls. He wasn't around. He was on vacation. And so I just kind of looked at the GM. It's like, well, start making some phone calls. Cause I'm wrench guy. You sit on phone guy.
Right. Yeah. <That's>, yeah.
Until the conversation gets technical and I need to be on the phone, you know, and so eventually, you know, that we found that system. But the one frustrating thing was, is everyone's busy right now getting contractors out. And so people, you know, people were like, well, we'll see, you know, we'll see when we can get there. We'll see when we can get there. We'll see when we can get there. And, you know, in the meantime, we're just doing our thing. And, you know, eventually somebody shows up and here we are digging a hole again for the fourth time. And of course, everybody going past the health club. Oh, how many, you know, God, you guys are digging this, you know, trenching up the roadway again. It's like, yeah, I heard about the definition of insanity and we thought we might test it a few times.
Yeah. Like, we got a lot of bodies.
Yeah, that's gonna be the next one after a while. It's like, yeah, I know, we've dug this hole up four times.
Yeah.
Thank you for reminding us.
Yeah.
But the thing was, is even though not every day was a long day, there was just a certain amount of just stress and uncertainty and, you know, what's going on with this thing. And in we actually finally found the leak, whatever it was, 2 weeks ago now, a little more, got it repaired. That took another week to get someone out here to repair it. And now I was able to pull the pipes out and look at them side by side, and they looked exactly the same, like the exact same. They looked like they were the same leak. It was almost like the same piece of pipe.
Oh, wow.
And so it was really bizarre. So I got a hold of the manufacturer actually. And it turns out that the guy that responded to me is like one of their primary engineers on this product and like super genius. And, we had a Zoom meeting for 10 o'clock today. Cause we have a board president who just thinks that everything should happen right now. Like one day when the plumber hadn't shown up, you know, for a day or two, he like where he was going with the conversation was like, the next question is, can you make them come here? Cause that's all that was left.
Yeah.
Yeah. Like, how do we make them come here? And he kept saying, you don't, you know?
Yeah.
Like, it's like, you don't. Yeah. It's like, we make the phone calls, we do our due diligence, and then you have to be patient.
If you want someone who will come immediately, you got to employ that person on your payroll.
Yeah, exactly. That's
Otherwise, so you're working on whatever time frame they give you.
Yeah. It was just fascinating watching this and it's kept going, and it's just reminded me why, you know, there's being, you know, patient and, you know, being okay with things not happening on our timeline, and that, you know, sometimes you have to share those timelines with other people's is actually a good thing, and that it gets you through it with some grace and some dignity rather than coming across like someone that's, you know, just verging on asking the craziest of questions.
Yeah.
But today, like I said, I got a hold of this engineer guy. He basically said, yeah, your pipes, it doesn't work. We do not have a product that works for your application at all. It will fail. Always. Oh, wow. It will always fail.
So he's telling you it's just going to keep happening then.
Yeah. Wow. Oh yeah. Yeah. And it's just going to get worse. And, you know, he's like, I'm so sorry for giving you this news. I'm like, I'm not.
Yeah.
You just made it real easy. We're taking the pipe out.
Yeah. I mean, yeah. Something else has to be done. The pipe is not an answer at this point. Yeah.
This is, you know, and that was when the board president again was like, I don't care what pipe you find, replace it. And it's like, I do care.
Yeah.
Because clearly we put the wrong thing in once, ain't doing it again out of expediency.
Yeah. It's also really easy to say, I don't care, blah, 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 put it in when you're not the one actually putting it in.
Yeah, and yes, you do need big picture people at the right times.
Yeah.
And that was like where Joe and I were getting to. It's like, you know, we have 50 feet of the roadway we still haven't dug up yet. And, you know, do we dig this pipe up? And it's like, well, now we will. And before it was like, I don't know. You know, is it, we just didn't know. And now we know something. And then, you know, make some other phone calls, and it's like, you know, I'm like, oh, maybe we can get this done in the next few weeks. Nope, we're probably going to not get it done until Christmas, and that's not going to happen, so we'll have to wait till after Christmas.
Yeah.
And in the meantime, we just have to do our, you know, do what we can. We might have to dig it up and fix it again in the next 2 months. Who knows? You know, the way that it was explained to us is like, we're on a ticking time bomb every minute.
Wow.
So, yeah, at least now we know that, you know, we've got heaters. I can heat the building with electric heaters, and I came up with a workaround to, you know, heat hot water that we can do again. And, you know, we have a plan for going forward. Now it's just allowing the pieces to fall together. So what the other thing that was happening at the same time is my hobbies and interests were, I guess that's, I would say I was feeling the pressure of commitments.
Okay.
And having too many commitments.
That's understandable.
And a couple weeks ago, I hit what I call the F it phase, where I basically tell everyone that I quit. I am not quitting my job, my wife, or my pets.
Right.
And everything else can just go take off.
Right.
And it was, there's this one, at the beginning of the month, our drummer in the band was going to be gone in Costa Rica for a few weeks. And he said, you know, we said, what do we want to do right now? And I was like, I really want to finish this album. You know, we still have a lot of work to do.
Yeah.
And you know, Jason agreed. He's and we had a few things we needed to do, and we did it one night. And then by the next week, it's like, okay, rehearsal. And I'm like, what did I, like, did I not have this conversation last week?
Yeah. Do you know what I think it comes down to? I wonder, is like, they see you as working on that. Like, that's your time to do that. Like, you do it after work, you do it whatever. And I think, and tell me if I'm wrong. And in your head, you're like, I have X hours a week for band. So it's either rehearse or work on album, but those are your band hours essentially.
Yeah.
And they don't see it quite the same thing, same way.
Yeah, they think that there should be time for both, or what? Who knows?
Yeah,
I don't know. And I've said this over and over again. I'm good at dedicating myself to one thing. If I start multitasking, everything gets a little effort.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas if I don't multitask, I can give something all the effort.
Yeah.
And yeah, you know, I went, and it was like you were talking about with the art stuff. We've got a new band member that we're playing with. Because here's the other thing is I don't know how I feel from day to day because I don't know what's going to happen at work.
Right.
Like, I don't know. It could be an easy day. It could be extremely difficult. And there was this day that was, I was so tired. But I said, I'm going to practice and I went there. I didn't even stand up. I sat on the couch the whole time. like Tom even dragged the microphone to me just so I could sing. Actually, I had one of the best rehearsals I've ever had. Cause I think I was just so relaxed. I was just feeling it, you know? And yes, it was great. But the reality is I'm not clearing the clutter in the back of my mind. And so a Monday rolled around and right away it was a list of all the songs we want to rehearse this week. And all I had in my head was Middle Fingers Flying Up.
That's a great song. Right? I like that song.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I was like, this is not a place I want to be in where just even conversations about things that I love to do are irritating me. And so I had to put a boundary down. I wrote an email saying, you know, I'm at the efforts. This is what this definition is. And that means that I need to get stuff taken care of. These are my priorities. These are not priorities to me right now.
Yeah.
And until I get the priorities done, everything else can sit on the back burner unless something changes.
Right.
You guys get a gig next week?
I was just going to say, if you didn't have a gig, I understand you still want to practice, blah, 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 because it's fun. And also to stay, you know, keep the muscle memory there and whatever. But like you said, it's like, you know, at some point, like with this album, it's like it's just going to needle the hell out of you until you finish it, you know?
Well, that's it. That's where it's like I need to clear the clutter out. And so one of the things was finishing up a project for an artist that I'd started a long time ago. And we had long periods of time where things didn't happen. Mm-hmm. And I feel like I was treated really, I mean, I dropped the ball for sure. But I didn't deserve to be treated the way I was.
Right.
And at that point, I said, I'm done. Like, I will finish what I have on my plate, and then that's it. Like, we're done.
Mm-hmm.
And at one point, there was like, it's like, well, is there a possibility of doing something else? Because it actually has been enjoyable, but it's not going to, like we were talking, it's not happening on their timeline. It has to happen on my timeline, or you can go somewhere else.
Yeah.
And this is the site I was relating to you, Jen, in the fact that this is a negotiation. And if we cannot come to terms, it's not a judgment. It just means we couldn't come to terms.
Totally.
It means we are not client and provider, however you want to refer to it. Mm. Happens all the time.
Like if you watch like Pawn Stars, you see it all the time where somebody will have one price, they have a price, and they see that they're miles apart and just be like, hey, you know what? I'm going to pass, but thanks for bringing it in. All right, there you go. And everyone goes about their business. You know?
That's it. You come over to my house and I need you to bid on something and I don't, hey, can you, make the, no, and so we're just, I'm not your client. It's that simple.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You have a certain, and I have different expectations, and the same thing can go with any relationship.
Yeah.
It's just, we're just not seeing this the same. And it's not a judgment call. It's just a difference of view. And so I was thinking like, okay, well maybe there's a possibility. And I thought, yeah, but I saw what the effect is of not meeting their expectations.
And it was very, it was an abusive relationship type situation.
Yeah.
Like, oh, come on, I'll change if you just do this. And it's like, I've seen how you behave. Like,
And that's all of a sudden I went, wait, why would I do that? Somebody showed me their true colors.
Yeah.
They painted it on the wall. Why would I not, they gave me the information. This is who I am. Why would I not believe them?
Right. Yeah. I was going to say, it's like that thing you see going around on the internet a lot right now. It's like when someone shows you who they really are, believe them,
believe
and it's
them.
Like, yeah.
And so I went, oh, that's right. I get to believe them. And I haven't even thought about it since then. So then the next thing was I had a couple of podcasts to edit. And I knew that it was going to be a full night each time. And I did it. I got them out of the way. Two really fun podcasts. I really enjoyed them. But I spent 3 hours, two nights in a row, editing a conversation instead of doing music.
Right.
And it kind of hit me. I edited a conversation.
Right.
For hours. I had the conversation for an hour.
Right.
And then I edited it for three.
That's something I don't think a lot of people know. And it's part of why I don't really edit the two shows that I do, is because it's a conversation. You know, if we had we were very on topic and this point, maybe, okay, this is a little blah, maybe, you know, things that aren't interesting. But it's like, there's a speed up button on like every player. There's, you know, it's like, if you don't like what's going on, just scrub ahead a little bit. But because part of it is, like you said, it's like you sit there and you talk all that time. Then you listen to yourself at least one more time doing it, usually more, because sometimes you'll be like, and you go back and, like, when the episodes of the shows where I have done some editing, I've listened to parts of the show for like 4 or 5, 6 times. And I'm like, by the end, it's got to be similar to like when people write for a TV show. By the time it actually airs, those jokes are not funny to them anymore because they've heard them 1.5 million times. There's no, and it's just like, oh yeah, I remember, that's a funny bit. Like when you hear a comedian, you know, or somebody go back and listen to a show they did, they'll be like, oh, this is really funny. But you don't really hear them laugh. Because it's not, you know, going to draw a laugh out of you anymore. So I could see where it'd be the same, you know, like to me, that's the same thing with editing podcasts, is that by the time I've done it, I just want it gone. I don't want to ever see it again. I don't want to hear it again. I'm just done with it.
And I'm just like, that's just a waste of my time now at this point. If I'm already getting stressed over the commitments of my hobbies, maybe this has to be put into some value.
Yeah.
And it just made me, and like, that's why even like last week, I was as stressed as I was. I wanted to podcast. Yeah. You know, like tonight, I just happened to be able to get on tonight, but I wasn't going to happen because I had an opportunity to do some more album work tonight and I didn't need to spend that much time, but I've been wanting to talk about this.
Yes.
You know, like these are what really brings me a lot of joy, what makes me feel good. And, you know, that process is not high on the list. And I think it's time to make some adjustments and some changes there. And because every time I do, I feel better. I'm being honest to myself and I'm being honest with other people. And I know nobody wants me to be doing something that doesn't make me happy.
Right.
And then, you know, and so then and that felt pretty good last week, you know, like it was a good week getting those two podcasts out, and I got into the album work again, and then the weekend comes along and it's like, oh, I got stuff to do around the house, or I have other things I want to do. And that's why it's like, people like, oh yeah, why aren't you spending your Saturday working on my project? And it's like, 'cause I got leaves to rake.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
Like,
I
have other things that I have to do as well.
Right.
You know, I have to winterize every vehicle. I have to put them away, blah, 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 get ready for snow. You know, anyhow.
Because I'm working a full-time job and doing trying to do a second job. Yeah.
Yeah.
Plus upkeep on your life. To,
what's my part in this? Mm-hmm. Well, I've agreed to these things. All right. So now how do I make it so that I can be happy again? And one of them is get the clutter out. And so that was like, okay, now I can work on the album. Did one whole song that we have 2 songs left that need to be kind of edited and uploaded. Got one edited and I was like, there's something wrong with this song and I don't know what it is. And I sent it out again. I've said it a bunch of times that there's something not right. And this time Tom said, yeah, I really want to re-record those guitars. And I'm like, yes. So that's what I did tonight, is I took all the recording gear over there and I set it up. And it was cool is Tom and Patrick were over there rehearsing. So they... this is what I'm happy about. They kept doing their thing. Even if I'm not there, they're still working towards the goals. Thank you.
Yeah.
Don't have to be there.
Yeah.
And especially if it's making me go, you know, throw the
right.
The I love you gang sign up.
Yeah.
You're number one. And that's what it was making me feel. And so I don't know where I'm at with the podcast yet. I know my goal right now is album done as soon as possible. And I'm working towards that goal. Luckily this weekend I've taken care of most of the stuff around the house, and it just felt right to like, I need to establish boundaries and I need to really look at, you know, and I need to remind myself that I don't have to say yes to everything.
Yeah.
And I don't have to do these things. And the other part is there are nights now because of work where I get home and I don't want to do a thing.
Yeah.
And I've honored that. I have gone and hung out with my dog. And I was like, and that's part of, you know, that was the other thing is like, that's me doing self-care.
Right.
You know, same thing with like, maybe if I just want to, well, like when Cheeto, you guys FaceTime me, I was, you know, cleaning up my space a little bit and, you know, moving equipment around. And do I have to do it? No,
yeah.
But it's going to make me feel better.
Yeah. Well, that was why I was just like, well, we can text him. That's why I didn't just like, oh, well, I'll just, you know, and just, you know, FaceTime bomb you out of nowhere. I was like, oh, well, let's just see if he's busy, you know, like.
Yeah, it was perfect. I love talking and like doing something like when my friends call me, like they want to have a talk.
Yeah.
I typically clean the house while I'm doing it. It's a weird thing. I pick up a bottle of 409 and a rag and I start cleaning stuff.
Well, it's funny because before we recorded, I was telling Jenna, I don't know if you caught any of that or not.
I did.
How I looked up why, because I talked with my one therapist about that. But like, why do a lot of us walk around when we're on the phone?
Yep.
And so it makes sense. You're actually doing something productive. I just pace. So the best I do is maybe polish the floor with my feet.
Yeah, for some reason that it's just I'll even do it when Sharon's having something really heavy she wants to talk to me about.
Oh, geez.
I'll suddenly start polishing the top of the stove. And she's like, you know, it's kind of annoying, but it is kind of nice at the end.
Right.
We need to have heavy discussions more often.
Right. Like, listen, we got the discussion out of the way and the stove is clean. So that's extra win.
So what's the title of the show? It's okay.
Yeah.
You know, because that's kind of it falls into this. It's also just I need to value myself a little more right now, and I need to take care of myself. And part of it is also taking care of other people, meaning I make commitments, follow through on them.
Yeah.
And don't take on other ones until I follow through.
You're not taking all your space up. You know,
I'm not going to complain about it because I'm the one that put myself here.
Yeah.
This was a choice I made. And yeah, maybe the information that I made this choice on what turned out to be different after a while. And in some cases it was, but in other cases it wasn't. And I don't want to just quit everything. So it's about just being open and honest about where I'm at, what I can do. And then getting down and doing it.
Yeah.
And not just procrastinating. And it's feeling good, and it makes me it gets me away from that drastic point.
Right.
Which
sucks because like when you hit that, like when you're backed into a corner, not just you, I mean anyone in general.
Yeah.
We typically don't act rationally. Like a lot of times like you were saying, all you want to do at that point is you go into survival mode and you're just like, well, F this, F that, F that. You know, like it's
I'm out.
Yeah. And it's like, whoa, that's not, you know, when you really look at it, that's probably not how you want to react. But in that scenario, you do, because you're just like, I just want this to not be all of this, you know?
Yeah, the anxiety and stress. I mean, I started having indigestion again and, you know, trouble sleeping, waking up in the middle of the night thinking about work. And it's like, I ain't doing this.
Yeah.
Nope.
Yeah.
It's a job. That's
right.
All it is. I don't care that some people think of it as more of one.
Yeah.
It's a job.
Right.
Yeah.
I can leave tomorrow and somebody else will fill my shoes and do the job.
Yeah.
That's, you know.
Yeah. That was why weeks, months, whatever it was ago when we talked and, you know, because I kind of was feeling that you might be kind of feeling that way then. And I was like, hey, with this podcast, you know, if we're recording and you don't want to, totally cool. We understand. If you do, that's great. We love having you on here, you know, and that always holds. And that's why if you're like, hey, I got this, you never see me going, oh, come on. You know, it's always just like, okay, cool. And we just make other plans.
Yep.
So because I understand that feeling like with stuff, and especially when it's something that, you know, as much as like even me, like as much as I love doing the podcast and stuff, there's times where they just feel heavy. And that it's like, I don't really want to do this tonight or this week or whatever. And, you know, we all have that with something in life. And especially like, you know, when I do a podcast, it's like, because I know I got to sit here and do the other stuff afterwards and the promo, you know, it's like, to me, like you were saying about like that 3 hours, it's like, I'll be sitting doing it for a few hours,
yeah, a little
getting
bit,
everything done, you know, which is fine. I'm okay with that. But there's obviously times where you're just like, I don't want to do this. Like, I just want to be like, meh, you know. But I committed to it. I've said I'll do it, so I do it, you know.
And I really appreciate that. And I really needed to talk about this. I needed to talk about it because it's more than just – like, I was telling, my friend Neil about it, and he could tell in my voice, he's like, wow, you really sound down. And I'm like, I am. I am not in a good place right now.
Right.
I feel fatigued. And but talking to him doesn't do it as much as, like, talking directly to the people that I'm involved with.
Because there's no real solution base in that. You're just sounding bored.
I'm just venting.
Yeah.
And it's fine. It helps me process my thoughts. But,
sure.
Yeah, so I'm grateful to be able to at least talk about this and know that there's understanding and that it's probably Jen's bedtime at this point.
Oh, I thought you were. Right. I thought you were going to.
I'm still awake. Thank you.
You are. I haven't even seen you nod.
I have not
impressive.
Nodded.
Yeah.
I know. Explored. You're totally in it.
Yeah, I'm assuming she's got some sort of sharp implement she just keeps jabbing herself with occasionally. Like just a nail in the side or something.
Because I'm
amazed
because how she's pod. I mean, she's podcasting on the pillows like the princess.
Yeah.
Yeah. I am a princess.
Exactly.
No, actually, I will say, and I'm sure you guys can also attest to, I have seen and felt such an amazing difference since I started that new med.
Yeah.
Excellent.
Yeah,
it has completely changed my sleep cycle. It has completely changed everything.
That's wild because I've never seen anything you've been on affect it that way. Usually it's the other way where some will make you sleepier, so that's wild.
Yeah,
I am about 2.5 hours past my bedtime and I'm tired, but I'm still going.
Yeah.
Yay.
Having said that, she's got like an hour climb to the top of her bed, so
I
that's true. It's time to start on that journey.
Yeah, she's got to get her Sherpa and
one of these days I will post a picture of it on Facebook for you folks to see.
What would be funny is
no
to
one
do
believes me.
You need to do like a little paper cutout or something of you. And then show it with like a stick on it and make it look like you're climbing the bed.
Or a little rope or something.
Yeah.
Because no one believes me when I say it's a 4 foot tall bed and they're like, okay. And then I show it to them like, my God.
Yeah.
Seriously. I told you.
It's like, yeah, you got to wear a harness up here. And I don't mean that in any sort of dirty way. You know, like this one's for safety.
Like, yeah, like, oh, wow, kinky. It's like, no, I'm serious. You should have a harness on and a rope.
Yep.
Yeah. Let me put my security rails up.
Yep, that's right.
Oh, it's even better.
So, all right, guys, well, I think we're good. We good?
Yep.
Yeah.
Sweet. All right, it's been fabulous catching up, and as you folks know, sorry, my brother just texted me something very funny.
Okay.
Anyway, so we covered a ton of topics tonight, a ton of information, and a ton of subjects. So a lot of high moments, a lot of awesomeness, a lot of things we're working on. So I know you have comments, constructive criticism, and just overall words you want to share with us. So please reach out to us. You know how to do it. You can continue the conversation with us at thecrazylifepodcast.weebly.com is our website. thecrazylifepodcast@outlook.com is our email address. And if you want to reach me, you can reach me through Facebook or through either one of those methods. And Brian, how can they reach you? Oh, wait a minute. We're going to go Heno next. Heno, how can we reach you?
You can find me on Twitter at Ida Heno. You can find me on Facebook and Instagram, Heno Heiter. And if you want to check out the podcast I was talking about, Moving the Needle Podcast, where we don't have that many ums and likes because I go through and cut every single freaking one out of them.
That's why I'm never on the show.
I put extra in our shows to make up for it.
Yeah, there's extra likes there.
Yeah.
But we did a really fun for Halloween Hellraiser versus Hellraiser, the old one versus the new one.
Nice.
And we also did a Test of Time, The Jerk. So
oh, man, nice.
Be out either. Yeah.
I haven't watched that movie in a long time.
Yeah. Oh, for all you youngins out there, go get it. It's such a good movie.
Well, go listen to Heno's podcast and see if it holds up.
Oh, my bad. True.
Jeez, Jen, come on. Push the product. Jeez.
Well, this doesn't bode well for your trip for the company.
Yep.
True.
Oh, man. Well, if you want to find me, you can find me on Twitter and Instagram at Stunami. You can find my other podcast at salty_language or at saltylanguage.com. That show is not safe for work, so please be careful how or where you're listening to it and what, you know, put the AirPods or earbuds or whatever you have in your ears. And we're going to be recording a new episode tomorrow, but the last episode that's up is 585. And we talk about like the creepy photo of an ant's face up close. Our trip to Cheeto Banditos.
And that's not Aunt Millie.
No. the weirdness of animals' reactions to, you know, like us leaving. And, like, the reactions of, like, you know, Tony's dog being like, oh, my God, I can't believe you left me this long. And my cat being like, yeah, I see you're back and just ignoring me. You know. So, yeah, if any of that sounds like fun. Oh, I talk about making cowboy caviar. Or, actually, I talk about eating cowboy caviar. I made it this week. So, that was quite tasty. And, you know, so I believe the recipe's in the show notes for that episode, too. So, if any of that sounds like fun to you, please go give us a listen. And we're part of the Tangent Bound Network, which can be found at tangentboundnetwork.com. So please go check out the shows there. We're on Facebook at facebook.com/group/crazylifepodcast if you'd like to jump over there. Sorry, my list didn't update. There we go. Finally did. I think that's all the plugs anyway. So real quick before we get to the rest, I also want to thank Lady Jinx for being on the last episode. She was a lot of fun, and I felt like we had a pretty good conversation. So thank you to her for that. I meant to say that at the beginning of the show and forgot, so I'm glad I remembered it. But, please be nice to one another. Share some kindness when you can. Please try not to, we're in the like wind down for the midterm elections, but please try not to be jerks to each other over this. Like really just stop this garbage. And of course, as always, if you need help, please reach out. There's all sorts of help out there for you. And I understand it's real tough. I didn't mention earlier, you know, like the doctor that I, you know, prescribed testosterone to me for sent out a letter that apparently he just had a new grandson and it made him reconsider life and he decided to retire basically as of that notice.
Oh wow.
I mean, he's in his, I think, 60s or so, you know, but I was just like, oh, okay. Which really stinks because I really liked everybody in that office. So
yeah.
I'm very sad to see, I mean, I'm happy for him, but I'm sad to see that I have to now navigate becoming a new patient with somebody else and going through all the intro stuff again and blah blah blah. So I understand that, you know, the anxieties and all that stuff out there, but please reach out. Please, you know, talk to your friends if you know they're going through a hard time and make sure, you know, that they're okay and just let them know you're there for them. Sometimes that's all the person needs. So yeah,
absolutely. And with that, folks, if you take anything from this podcast, take away this: everything that we do needs to be celebrated and appreciated. So be your biggest cheerleader and go out there, have the best week you possibly can, and never forget, don't forget to wiggle those toes.